Because when we were building the airplane as it was taken off and printed these envelopes, we failed to put a space on there for you to put your phone number. And if you're using credit cards, very, very important that we have your phone number on there. So, again, we're going to take up one offering. That's going to be tomorrow. We invite everyone to participate who wishes to at that time. But if you need to before, for whatever reason, you're invited to leave your offering in the basket, so we'll take care of it. If you use a credit card, again, put it on, use one of these envelopes, please make certain that you put your phone number on there. And with that, I want to tell you a little story. This goes back, how old are you now? 40. All right, so this goes back 27, 28 years ago. Beth and I were in DeLand, Florida. We were youth pastors at a congregation there. And we'd been there for a few years as youth pastors. And you had to be 13 to come into the youth group. And we had a whole slew of kids that were 11, 12, just waiting to get into the youth group. And some of them we kind of let come in a little early. One of them, when he arrived in the youth group, brought a saxophone with him. And this young man was it was always impressive how focused he was, how goal-oriented he was, no lack of confidence whatsoever. None. And he brought this saxophone with him, and he would practice it wherever we were. And at the beginning, he was awful. And it was torturous. Because he'd bring that saxophone with him all over the place, and he would blow and he would rehearse, and it was just, I'm like, fingernails on the chalkboard kind of torture. Well, let's jump ahead. When was your number one album? 2011. So that's 9 years ago. This young man, Gabe Bellow, had the number one jazz album in the country, beating out people like Michael Bublé. So he's the little engine that could. So, some of you got it. Some of you don't worry about it. But anyway, we're very proud of Gabe and just his testimony and his tenacity, his good nature, his always being upbeat and positive, and his talent and his gift that he is presenting unto the Father. And so we're excited and appreciate the fact that he's going to bless us now with a saxophone rendition of the Hanukkah song. So this is Gabe Bellow, everybody. All right, you know that old saying about it's sometimes easier to get forgiveness than it is permission? Give them just a little snippet of that little tribute band, the first one that you did. Give us a little snippet, all right? Oh, I know, boy. I'm putting you on. Gabe, until COVID, also had a couple of little musical enterprises. He did a tribute band. And one of them, what was it called? The Natural Wonder?
Mm-hmm.
All right, give us about 30 seconds of that.
Which you have a...
You choose. Just make certain that it's rated G.
Oh, boy. It's all G-rated. I was telling some folks yesterday, you know, I love it that people pay me tons of money. Well, not tons of money. I'm not rich. Don't get the wrong impression. You see my card, be like, he's not rich. But, you know, they pay me to sing to what they think to go sing secular music. But, in fact, I use those opportunities to share the gospel and share my testimony how the Lord healed me of cancer. So... Music gives the world within itself with a language we all understand. With an equal opportunity for all to sing and dance, clap their hands. Just cause the record has grown, don't make it in the groove. You can tear out a band that's aiming, the people start to move. You can feed it all over. You can feed it all over.
And that was on the spot there. He wasn't ready. He didn't know I was going to do that. Thanks, Gay. We appreciate it, man. Okay, do everybody get your coffee, get your nap? Well, if you didn't, you're going to have to, if you have a wife, let her pull your hair and stimulate your brain. If you don't have any hair left, well, stimulate his brain anyway, ladies. But I want you to all have a seat, get ready. I want you to put your thinking caps on because one of the smartest people I know and most insightful people into the Word and just brings out things that I would have never thought of, Dr. Hollisa Alewine is going to come and share with us now. So let's give her a big hand, will we? Now you got to keep clapping until she gets up here. So it's a long wait while for up there.
Good afternoon. I'm the original bag lady. I have props, and I never know which one I'll need because I never know what I'll say. But we have... You know, the usual menorah, the revolving menorah that everybody likes. But I have just acquired a new menorah. And how many of you have ever tried to explain a chiasm to someone else? Okay, how many of you know what a chiasm is? Okay, is it hard to explain it to other people? Okay, is this easy? Four horses, seven seals, right? Four living creatures, one Holy Spirit. That's how you explain it. It was that easy. I'm not sure what else I have in there other than Gatorade. But good to see you guys come out for Hanukkah. And we're shining our light, right? And that's the good news. It just gets darker and darker and darker. And we get... Very good. Excellent. I really am on board with the message of community. You know, we've been so privileged in our congregation. We've been around since the late 90s, I think. And we're small, but just having that community for basic events, for births, for deaths, for marriages, for the kids' graduation, and all those things... Those things, that, you know, they're they're life markers. And we need people of like kind and like mind to help us share those moments. What about when your child makes a profession of faith in Messiah? Having a community just to share that event with, that's a big deal. And so finding a good community is a challenge. It's not easy. That's why there's not a lot of people doing it. And there's not a lot of rewards for leadership. Honestly, because how many of you know that every day on the internet is a fresh, steaming pile of distraction? And if you're the leader of a congregation, people are going to print off and bring into the congregation those fresh, steaming new piles of information for you to sort through for them. So it's a challenge. It's not just the pastoring aspect. You're also expected to be a crack teacher. You're also expected to be an apologist. Not in apologizing, but as in explaining things. Well, probably apologizing too, if you're a pastor. Y'all do a lot of apologizing. There's a lot of things you have to be in order to lead a congregation. And we can either say we have informed sheep or we can say we have over-informed sheep. That's a challenge. And so we don't need to make their jobs harder. We need to help. And we need to pitch in and feel part of those communities. I would like to maybe augment. We were listening last night in the RV as we were trying to get set up. We listened to last night's service. And then, of course, listening to the goat, Mark, this morning, talk about the goat. Completely on board with that. And maybe I can just add an element that will help you see the importance of becoming part of one of these communities. Because if we're just out there scattered, and we are, we're in exile. I mean, by nature of where we're sitting, we are not in Jerusalem. So we're in exile. If you're not in Jerusalem, especially at the feast, you are in exile. You're not home. And so, as weird as it sounds, we're actually in captivity. That's what happens in exile. They got taken out of Jerusalem. They were taken out of Judea. They were taken out of Israel. They were taken to Babylon. They were scattered among the nations, and therefore, Israel is in captivity. And weird as it sounds, captivity is out there, not in here. And so there's going to have to be a reversal of that. And, of course, the return from Babylon is our example of what it means to come out of Babylon, come out of her, come out of her, my people. But if we are in exile, if we are in Babylon, so to speak, there's a coming out that we need to do before we go back to Jerusalem. And I think that's the function of these communities. I think it's to help us to build the knowledge of a place where the priests of Israel were failing miserably. In the times of the prophets, they said, "You're not teaching my people the difference between clean and unclean." And so that's why I say your pastors, your rabbis, whatever you have in your congregation, they have to be crack Torah teachers. If they're supposed to rectify what was part of the problem and sending the Jews into exile and sending Israel into exile, they have to teach you the difference between clean and unclean. They have to teach you the heart of the Torah, and that's done in community. Most of those things have to do with how you relate to one another. And so if I can augment that, if I can show you something beautiful, if I can show you that you are actually in a point in history, and maybe don't you realize it. How many of you have ever been a place and you didn't realize until after it was over how important that event was? Or how important even that one sentence was in changing a life? Maybe yours, maybe someone else's. And if we look back in history, most people, probably like the Maccabees, they knew they were in tough times, but they probably didn't have any idea we'd still be talking about them today. They were just doing what they needed to do at the time. And so we just need to do what we need to do at this time. You're in history, and what you do does make a difference. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to skip where I started at River of Life, which is a review of the seven shepherds and the eighth prince. We can go back to it tomorrow. I want to start in the middle. And the reason I want to start in the middle is in memory of Brad. Because Brad liked to teach things that I just don't normally teach. He was very interested in the exiles and the lost sheep and the coming back. And the strange thing is, the more you get into Midrashic rabbinic literature, don't let your eyes roll back in your head, just hang on, focus. The more you get into rabbinic Midrashic literature, the more you realize how they emphasize the return of the exiles. And that's where I'd like to take us. I want to take us, not there. We're going to go forward really, really, really fast, hopefully. And I want to get to the name like purified oil. And then we can go back and we can talk tomorrow if there's time about the seven shepherds and the eighth prince and how that was the expectation of Hanukkah, was that when Messiah came, he would at that time destroy Edom, he would destroy the red one, and he would bring back the lost exiles of Israel along with another group of people. And that's what I want to look at today. When they asked Yeshua in the temple at the Feast of Dedication, if you're the Messiah, tell us plainly, he told them so explicitly who he was that they tried to stone him. So if we don't understand sheep relative to Hanukkah, then we've missed what they actually asked him and the whole context of his answer. We can get to that. That's more of a review. If you haven't read the book, you can get the book back there on the table. What I want to get to is the strangest of places that speaks about the return of the exiles. How many of you think Song of Songs might be the raciest book in the whole Bible? You don't let the kids read that one until they get married, right? Well, when you start unpacking the Song of Songs and doing the close textual studies, what you realize, it's not that racy at all. In fact, it'll just ruin it for racy once you find out what the twins are. Okay, he read it, but it's actually referring to the twin tablets, by the way. And you're like, oh my goodness, that didn't sound like what I thought it was. And that's the way the Song of Songs is. There are so many undercurrents of the restoration of the exiles that are contained within a parable of the resurrection and returning to the Garden of Eden. In fact, much of what the rabbis expect the Garden of Eden is and will be like is taken directly out of the Song of Songs. So I wanted to take one verse. We've been studying now for a few months in the Song of Songs, and we're on verse 4, I think. It's that deep once you start getting into it. But this is the one that when I read it and I started reading the commentary, it made me think of Brad and how he would be like, yeah, I talked to Eddie, and it's everywhere. And I'm like, really? I don't usually read it like that, but I can definitely read it like that in Song of Songs 1:3. And there's 3 points we want to go over, and it has to do with oil. In fact, let's back up. Maybe we won't. Okay. Let's think of what oil is. When you first take an olive, if you were to bite into the olive, what would it taste like? Horrible bitter. An olive is nasty until it's done through the curing process. But if you crush the olive to obtain the oil is nice, it's pleasant. We fry things in it, like donuts. We use it to put on salads, not as fun, but oil is good for so many things, including bringing light. And the oil, in its qualities, is kind of like a picture of us. And, you know, we all know the parable of the 10 virgins, right? So they're 10 virgins. They have an expectation that Messiah is coming. Five of them have extra oil. How did they get extra oil? What did it take to obtain extra oil out of the olive? Crush. You have to crush the olive in order to extract the oil. So there is a pain and a suffering. It's no coincidence that Yeshua is praying, if possible, let this cup pass from me, in the Garden of Gethsemane. The olive press. This is going to hurt. Suffering is coming. And so anybody that tells you that suffering doesn't go along with the kingdom of Messiah now is not telling you the full truth and nothing but the truth. In fact, your life will be marked, like Yeshua tried to tell Peter, your life will be marked by suffering. But the effect that it's going to have on you is at the end, you will be willing to let someone lead you to a place that you would never willingly go before. And that's what it takes in order to extract from the olive enough oil to endure until the bridegroom comes, in order to join that wedding party. They all had an expectation, but only half of them were willing to suffer what it took in the wait for the bridegroom in order to have enough oil to be able to cross that threshold. And that's a picture to us. Even though it feels bitter when we're being squeezed and compressed and taken those places we really don't want to go, you want to start a congregation? Please no. You want to start a congregation? Please no. You want to start a congregation, but the oil is oozing. And there's going to be people who can benefit from that crushing. And so that's us as a believer. The more we are crushed for the sake of Messiah, not our own stupidity, that's a different sort of thing going on. But the more we can see the point of being crushed, the more willing we are to be crushed for that moment that we've only been told about, we've only read about, but we believe it. How many of you absolutely believe Messiah is coming? The bridegroom is coming. And we have an opportunity to cross a threshold into a very holy place. That's what I want to talk about. Who was seen as part of this expectation associated with the oils? So it says, your oils have a pleasing fragrance. That's the first point. Your name is like purified oil. That's the second point. Therefore, the maidens love you. Third point. Now, each of those has a separate explanation, but they need to be read as one statement because each of those is related to the other. And that's our point. Olive oil is bitter at first. This wok can be bitter at first, but it's going to be sweet at the end because that oil is going to yield a clear light. And it's part of our purification. When we make a statement in Yeshua, typically what would follow that in a normal Baptist church? A baptism, an immersion, a purification by water. But there is also a principle of an oil of anointing, an oil of consecration, an oil of purification. The priest could not go in to minister until they had been consecrated with oil. A king had to be anointed with, right. So now you're not just purified, now you're set apart for a specific purpose. And I think sometimes that's why we get into so much trouble in our walk. We're not really sure what our purpose is. We know we're purified, we know we're walking with Yeshua, but we're kind of casting about there trying to find, well, what is my anointing? What is my gift? What exactly is it am I supposed to do? And when you don't know, is it possible maybe you get off in someone else's lane and you try to walk in their anointing that you have not yet suffered for? See, that's the thing. The anointing always brings suffering. How many of you in church, you pray like, just bring that anointing, and now you're thinking, well, let's think about the anointing first. Exactly what am I being anointed for? Because I want to know what I'm about to suffer for. Yeshua was the Mashiach. He was the anointed one. And he suffered for us. What are you willing to suffer for? Because with that gift that you're wanting, with that anointing that you're seeking, you need that because you are going to suffer. It will help you make it through those times of suffering. Because you know that in the end, it's going to be sweet. It will be worth it if I can hang on until the end. And look, if even Yeshua prayed, if possible, let this cup pass, don't think you won't have those moments. I don't think I can do this one more time. I don't think I can face this one more time. But you can. If you know what you're aiming for, that's what we want to do. We want to look at what you are aiming for so you'll know who you are. And the reason that when you go into a congregation, usually that means at some point the new is going to wear off and you're going to have to enter into some type of suffering for the sake of Messiah, for the sake of his body. So it says, first of all, your oils, it's plural. There's more than one. And there's two oils of anointing in Scripture. There's the oil of the Kohen, which is the priest, and there's the oil of the king, the oil of royalty. And so both of those, as they're inaugurated into service, they must both receive an anointing, the anointing of a priest and the anointing of a king. The anointing of the priest is the Shemen Hamishcha, and you can here, the same root word, Mashach, as in Mashiach, for Messiah. And you can find that in Exodus 30, 23 through 25. But Midrash Rabbah tells us about these two oils. It says the plural alludes to the fact that there are two fragrant oils, two kinds of anointment, two anointings. There is the Kehuna Vashemen, the high priest, and then the oil of the priest, the oil of the kingship. And so putting the priest and king anointings together really is vital to understanding Peter when he preaches. Peter is, once he gets on topic, he stays there. He doesn't move all around on you like Paul. Trying to follow Paul is like trying to go through a maze in one letter. But if you can get a hold of what Peter's saying, his message is pretty simple. In fact, he has a favorite verse. It's in Psalm 118. And he will continue to teach you that one psalm over and over and over to try to help you understand this principle of the two oils. So there's two doctrines that are founded upon it. Now, the one that you're used to seeing most often is 1 Peter 2:9. It says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. So the principle of the royal priesthood, Peter likes to preach that because in Peter's Jewish mindset of the first century, he knows about the two oils. He knows about the fragrant oils, and he knows everything that they represent because he knew Yeshua was challenged about it at the Feast of Hanukkah in the temple. Of course, we're not reading all that into it, but Peter has the background for these two oils, and he knows that there's two anointings, king and priest. And so now he applies it to the believer. He says, it's not just the priest of Israel, it's not just the king of Israel, but he says, now you share in that anointing. There is an aspect of both of those fragrant oils that now rests on you. And that's a beautiful verse. It's a wondrous verse. I mean, even the idea of being a king and a priest, that brings up an image in your mind. But does it also bring something to mind of how much you will have to suffer? That's what goes along with it. So it says, these two doctrines of the king and the priest are derived from that third statement. Therefore, do the maidens love you? And in the Midrash, it says the two oils of king and priest are an allusion to converts. Now, converts can, through their daughters, beget descendants who will become Kohanim, priests, and monarchs. Likewise, may descend from them, since even converts can attain such high positions, represented by the two oils. The maidens come to love you, God, and are eager to convert. All right, now this is taken strictly from a Jewish commentary, but they're making a very good point. And you've heard this sort of language before. You've even heard it from Paul. He said, therefore you, who formerly were afar off from the covenant, without hope in this world, you were strangers to the covenant. Now through the blood of Messiah, you have been brought near. That is based on an ancient rabbinic understanding that because of these two oils, the maidens will come to love you. And their example is Ruth. Ruth was a maiden who formerly was a stranger from the covenant. She was a Moabite woman. She was even without hope because her husband had died. She was a widow. She had nothing that would draw her into a little town called Bethlehem, other than a cranky mother-in-law. And that's not a real big impetus for us to make a long, painful, crushing journey with mother-in-law saying, go back, go back, go back. Don't come with me. You can't handle being Jewish. You don't understand the crushing that is involved in that. And nevertheless, Ruth makes the most profound statement of a convert in all of Scripture. Wherever you go, I go. Wherever you live, I live. Wherever you die, there I'll be buried. Your people are my people, and your God is my God. And that is understood to be a statement of conversion. Even though they didn't have formal conversions in ancient times, that statement said everything it needed to say. Now, do you think at that point she had already mastered 613 commandments? But who taught her? Her cranky mother-in-law. Have you ever learned Torah from somebody who was cranky? Me? Okay. Just catch me before 10 a.m. and you'll find out what a cranky Torah teacher's like. But Ruth makes that commitment. Whereas before, she had no hope in this world. But now, all of a sudden, with this profound statement of faith, Ruth's descendants become kings. Ruth's descendant is King David. Ruth's descendant is King Messiah Yeshua. So you see how fast something can change if you just have the faith that it will? She probably didn't foresee that she would be the ancestress of kings of Israel. She just knew what she was supposed to do in that moment. And so through that, she's brought near. And that's the hope of the maidens. That's their identity. The maidens are seen as all those people out there in the world, whether we see them as exiles of Israel, they're lost because they don't know who they are. They've been strangers to the covenant. They've lost their identity. Or whether they're just a pure convert. They have no lineage. They have no blood that ties them to the nation of Israel. But yet they say, your people are my people. Your God is my God. And that fast. That fast they are brought near. And even though they are not of that blood, once they marry into the covenant, their descendants do have the potential to become kings or priests. And they say, because of that, the maidens, the exiles, come to love Adonai. It's because of these oils of anointing they come to love him, because now there's hope. And it just takes you making that one decision in your generation to take that step of faith, and you don't know what that's going to do for your descendants. You don't know who's going to come out of that decision. And the apostles do. They teach this doctrine that through Yeshua, that this particular doctrine of the convert, the maidens who come to love Adonai because of the fragrant oils, that it's through the blood of the anointed one, the Mashiach, that now those maidens are brought near and given hope. And what's interesting is when we study the bloodlines of the tribes, we find that very early on, there is intermarriage between the tribes of Judah and Levi. It seems to be a pattern, not just from ancient times, but as we read in the Gospels, we find out that Mary had close kin who were of the tribe of Levi. They were Kohanim. So there had been some sort of intermarriage there between the tribes of Judah and the tribes of Levi, specifically the Kohanim. In fact, archaeologists who study the graves around Jerusalem say the pattern is there. In reality, you can tell from family names. They will fit into certain tribes, like this is somebody from the tribe of Judah, this is a Cohen. They say even through the grave inscriptions, you can tell that there was intermarriage between those two tribes. And so the pattern we have is that of the two fragrant oils coming together, giving hope to the convert, giving hope to those who formerly had no affiliation whatsoever to the covenant people. And so what we know about oil is that it does not mix very easily with other things. I mean, I know we have carrier oils. We probably have some in the back somewhere. If you go to a Hebrew Roots conference, you're going to find essential oils, by the way. You'll smell that before you get in the front door. So we do have an affinity for the fragrant oils of the priesthood and the oils of the monarchy. But they say the oil, that anointing is there because the oil of anointing, that fragrant oil, has a special quality. When you're anointed with that oil, then miraculously you enjoy the anointing of the oil along with the suffering that goes with it. But the impurities of the nations will not mix in with it. It goes back to what John was saying. Come out of her, my people. Well, we can't literally come out of Babylon, because anywhere outside the land of Israel is Babylon. And that captivity is eventually going to be reversed. It's going to be like the Garden of Eden. Those who go back inside the Garden of Eden will be in freedom. They will be within a perfect Torah of liberty, whereas the place of captivity will be outside the Garden of Eden, where there's unclean spirits, demons, unclean and hateful birds. So the principle of captivity is just going to get flipped over. But right now he says, in your captivity, you can come out of her. You can come out of her by virtue of the oils, those oils of Mashiach, the king and the priest. And if you were anointed with that oil of the Mashiach, and you were doing the suffering that goes along with it, then somehow the impurity that surrounds you out here in your captivity does not seep into you. Oil can actually, even in the physical world, serve as a coating to prevent things from getting in. That's how people used to waterproof jackets and things. They would have oil rubbed into them to prevent the water from getting in. And that's the oil of the Mashiach in this world. As we're out there rubbing elbows with the impure things of the world, we can't drive down the road without seeing something impure. We can't turn on the radio without hearing something impure. We can't even turn on the evening news without seeing impurity. But yet, those impurities do not have to mix in you. You don't have to be, what was the word? The Hellenization does not have to be knocked out of you. Because you're purified. You're ready. You've got the anointing of Mashiach. And so that anointing of Mashiach in you recognizes that impurity, and it changes the channel. It turns the knob. It turns the eye away from that billboard. It might mean that it elbows some friends away. It might mean that you find that community, you find that congregation where you can be pure in the middle of Babylon. Because that community is going to be what holds you accountable. And it would be nice if it weren't true, but we tend to behave better when we're around people who are watching. So until that time, to where we're just going to act better because we are better, as we're learning to be better, it helps to have those of like kind and like mind that will stir us up. We need stirring. So Peter teaches this. In 1 Peter 2:4, he says, "And coming to him as to a living stone, which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God, you also as living stones." Right? Let's think of this. Living stones, living stones. What did the high priest wear on his breastplate? Stones. And they were inscribed with the names of the 12 tribes. So the names of the 12 tribes were sealed. They had a chatam, they had a seal right there over his heart. And so that oil of anointing that rested on the priest also extended to the 12 tribes that he was carrying over his heart as he ministered. And so those weren't just dead stones that he was carrying. What those stones represented were living stones, living people. He wasn't just walking around with pretty ornamentation. He was walking around because Israel is alive. Israel's not dead. They are living stones. And he says, "You're being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood." He's mentioning here the oil of the priesthood again. "To offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ." You notice it says spiritual sacrifices. There's the crushing. There it is. We're going to suffer. But here's the great thing about suffering. I found this out in junior high. If you're going to get in trouble, get in trouble with someone. All right, so now I'm all grown up and I know better. If I'm going to suffer, and I want to suffer for the sake of the kingdom, I want to suffer with someone. I want to suffer with those who understand the situation I'm in and they know how to pray with me. They know how to hold my hand when I'm feeling sorry for myself and belly aching about, well, only in my world would this happen. They say, "Okay, sweetie, all right, now dust yourself up and get back up. Get up there and do what you're supposed to do. Walk in your gift, walk in your anointing. You know what you're supposed to be doing today. Get up and go." And they're smiling while they're saying it. And that's what we need. We need that community, not of a living stone, me just looking all pretty out here like a solitaire, but as part of a community of living stones. And it's all symmetrical, it's all even, nobody's better than anybody else. But the ability to encourage one another as we are offering up these spiritual sacrifices that just aren't going to feel good. They'll feel good later. Remember, it's the oil. It'll be sweet later. But when you first crush it out, it just hurts. In verse 6, he says, "For this is contained in Scripture. Behold, I lay in Zion a choice stone, a precious cornerstone, and he who believes in him will not be disappointed." This is precious value then for you who believe. If you believe that, it's precious. But for those who disbelieve, the stone which the builders rejected, this became the very corner, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. For they stumble because they are disobedient to the word, and to this doom they were also appointed. Okay, that doesn't sound very encouraging, but it is encouraging because it's speaking about the stone to the living stones. It's because Yeshua was the cornerstone, that we are living stones, that we who formerly were afar off have been brought near. There is a point to our suffering. And that's why it's such a gift. Because when we suffer, we know there's a point to it. When you sacrifice for your children, is it because you think it's just, there's no point in it? I just enjoy suffering for my children? Or are you doing it for their future? You're doing it for their spiritual growth. You're doing it so they can become responsible adults. You're doing it so that their lives can be even better than your own. That's why you suffer. Nobody just suffers because they enjoy it unless they're sick. But he's saying, if you know what the point is to suffering, then he says it's precious value because we're all going to suffer. Tribulation is here. Whether it's the tribulation of a generation or whether it's the great tribulation, who knows? I tend to think we're on a very specific cycle right now. I don't know if it's the last one because these things go in cycles. But this COVID-19 kicked off on January 7th, the 10th of Tevet, which is a fast day. Ezekiel said this fast lasted either 18 or 30 months. It depends, scholars argue. If it's on an 18-month cycle, then Jerusalem is sealed up. Jerusalem came under siege. You couldn't get in or out. How many of you have been able to get into Jerusalem to celebrate a feast since the siege began? Who was able to get out of Israel since the siege began? Not many. That was the whole point. You're sealed up. You're right where you are. Jerusalem's under siege. Now, Ezekiel says it's a slow boil. It's very slow. Put another stick on the fire. Put another piece of meat in the pot. It's not going to happen fast. It's going to build over time. If it's 18 months, then you're going to see a breach in the wall on the 17th of Tammuz, which is the fast of the fourth month. And then you'll see the wall come down on the 9th of Av. What does that mean in spiritual realms? I don't know, but I can see we got a plague. I can see Jerusalem sealed up, exactly like Ezekiel said. And so I'm paying way more attention to minor fasts than I ever did before, because there's a point to this suffering. He lets this stuff fall on specific dates to encourage us so that this is precious value for you who believe. But then those who disbelieve are going to stumble and be offended. I want to be on the right side of that suffering, because either way, you're going to suffer. There's a point. This is how community helps us. This is his way of releasing us from Babylon. And that's why I think he's pulling communities together to travel together. It's kind of like the reversal of the captivity, like I'm saying. He brings them out of Egypt as a single group. Well, with the exiles, they're scattered all over the world. You can't bring them out the same way you brought them out of Egypt, where they already had an identity. But out here where you are forming an identity, either of the tribes or attached to the tribes. Doesn't matter. Whoever you think you are, if you're looking toward Jerusalem as the end of the exile, then you're a maiden like Ruth. You're beginning to get that mindset, wherever you go, I go. Whatever your feast is, that's my feast. Whatever your Shabbat is, that's my Shabbat. Whatever you say food is, that's what I say food is. Because what we're doing is we are tearing down that golden image of Nebuchadnezzar. We are tearing down the Tower of Babel. It just keeps reinventing itself in different generations. But we have this precious hope because there is a precious stone in Zion. It's called the Evan Shtia. Evan in Hebrew is stone. Shtia is foundation. And the Evan Shtia is what Peter is talking about. There is a stone on top of the Temple Mount. Right now it's covered by a gold dome. And that may sound like bad news, but I think it's actually good news for right now. I think for now it needs to be there. Because if it weren't there, the Crusaders would have probably chipped the whole thing off and carried it off. That was the problem. But there is a foundation stone where it said the ark stood. It's said to be the foundation stone of the world, and it's from the very dust of that place that mankind was formed. And so these passages in Hebrews that confuse us sometimes, because we know that Yeshua fulfilled the spring feasts. That's easy. We still get questions, well, did he really fulfill the fall feast yet, or are we waiting for that? And that's when we have that answer, which is yes. Everything runs in cycles. And in Hebrews, it talks about Yeshua's blood being brought in and sprinkled in the most holy place. And we know it's vaguely, we say, okay, this is Yom Kippur. I don't get everything that the writer is saying. But a Jewish reader does, because the Jewish reader knows that the blood of Yeshua needs to be sprinkled in the most holy place where the Evan Shtia is, the foundation stone. That was where man came from in his physical creation. And this is where Yeshua came to bring mankind back to. No matter where the maidens are in the world, Yeshua died, and he offered his blood in the heavenly places, in the place of the Evan Shtia, the foundation stone, not just to bring certain people back with a specific pedigree, but he actually opened up the way for any maiden anywhere in the world who is made glad by the fragrant oils to come back to Jerusalem, to come back to worship in the temple, to come back to the whole reason why we keep the feast. We know why we keep the feast: Passover, Shavuot, Sukkot. Why those? Because they will bring us back home. They will bring the captives back home. They will bring those who are already in a prison and they think they're free. They're beginning to figure out they're not free. We're actually in a prison. We're in Babylon. We're caged up. And he's opened the door. We didn't realize he opened the door 2,000 years ago. We thought he opened the door so we could do whatever we wanted to and make new holidays that would cause us to forget the value, that precious value. But in Daniel 2:35, this is King Nebuchadnezzar's image of himself. And what you realize he did is he took Daniel's interpretation of his dream, and rather than being instructed by it and repenting of it, he took it as information to replan. He came up with plan B. Because he's just like Nimrod. He called the nations in, if we read carefully. We don't know if he told them what he was about to ask them to do, but he calls the nations in, and he has built now a golden image of himself. And when all the band starts playing, everybody's supposed to worship and fall down before the golden image. Except we had a few guys there who had plan C. And the plan C is you won't see me bow to that image. And it's the engineers say that that image, according to its dimensions, would have never supported its own weight. They say that part of the gold that was sent to Nebuchadnezzar as a bribe before he actually destroyed the city, he took that gold from the temple and used it because it was miraculous that the strength of it was much greater than just natural gold, which is very soft. And so he used gold from the temple to support his own golden image. And because Daniel told him, well, yes, Nebuchadnezzar, you're the head of gold, but we've got these decreasing kingdoms here. They'll never be as strong. And he says, plan B, I'll make the whole image of gold. And therefore, my kingdom will last forever. And Isaiah addresses him, you said in your heart, king of Babylon, I will ascend above the throne of God. I will rise above the stars. I will sit on the mount of the Moed. I will sit up there on top of that temple mount. That's where he took his gold, according to the tradition. And I will extend my kingdom. And there were three people who had a problem with that. It only takes a few, right? A few troublemakers. And by bringing the nations in and making sure that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, I don't think I can pronounce them the way Bill did, at least not that fast. These are Hebrew royals. They're noblemen. They're the best of the best of Jerusalem. That's how the kings of Israel were buying off Nebuchadnezzar until the final siege. They would keep sending him goods from the temple, sending him craftsmen, wise people, just to delay the inevitable. And so that's how they happened to be in Babylon before Jerusalem fell. And he says, I've got these three noblemen from the tribe of Judah. If I can get these three noblemen from the tribe of Judah, if I can get the rest of the nations to bow to my image, then my kingdom will last forever. Of course, every silly Antichrist thinks that, but Daniel 2:35 tells us that the king of Babylon's wish to sit on the Mount of the Moed, to sit on the Temple Mount, how it's going to be overturned. It says, then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, the gold were crushed all at the same time and became like chaff from the summer threshing floors. The wind carried them away so that not a trace of them was found, but the stone that struck the statue became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. There's our stone. There it is. And so when King David, a descendant of the maiden who formerly had no hope in this world, but was brought near through the fragrant oils of the king and the priest of Messiah, King David goes up to the threshing floor that was the Temple Mount, and purchases the place of the Mount of the Moed. No sword, no spear, no fight. He just purchased. In fact, they would have given it to him. I suspect it might be that way again. It may be when King Messiah walks up onto the Temple Mount, they will not kill or destroy on that holy mountain. They will simply vacate the premises. Because he's going back to the stone, because he is the stone. He is the stone that struck the statue, which became a great mountain, which symbolizes the Torah, and filled the whole earth. There is no kingdom of men that can stand before the stone. There is no other person on earth whose blood can be sprinkled in that place that would open the way for all mankind, any maiden who was made glad by the name that is like purified oil. No one else can do that but King Messiah. And every kingdom that has gone before that, it's going to be just like the day that David went up on the threshing floor and cleared it off and said, this is for holy use. And we are going to build a temple here. And we are going to purify this mountain. And we are going to bring it to such a condition, just like you would read in Ezekiel. If you read in Ezekiel, even the horses' bells are holy. The average eating bowls in the city of Jerusalem are holy. So that once again, what is in the natural realm is purified enough so that, like the rabbis say, that the new Jerusalem, the Jerusalem that withdrew a little bit when Adam and Eve fell from the garden, it raised up. But once it's purified on earth by those fragrant oils, by the oil of the priest, the oil of the king, that made the maidens glad, who's bringing the maidens home, bringing them back to the foundation stone where they came from originally, that once it's purified now, New Jerusalem can come down as a bride adorned for her husband. Peter's quoting from Psalm 118. And you do it every year if you do a traditional Passover Seder. Now, I know a lot of times we write our own. You can even do your own online now, the way I understand it. But if you've never done a traditional one, at some point, probably not your first year, you'll be overwhelmed by Rabbi so-and-so. But there are things in that Orthodox Passover Seder that are very important. For instance, the liturgy of it. It gives you expectation. And Psalm 118 is where we find the passage that Peter keeps quoting about the cornerstone. And you'll remember, we'll get to Psalm 118 toward the end of the Seder, and sometimes we do it as a response. His mercy endures forever. His mercy endures forever. His mercy endures forever. And I've never done that where it didn't build of its own accord. When the Spirit started moving within the people who were responding, His mercy endures forever. His mercy endures forever. And you can feel it's like you're better, you know, you're going to take off. Elijah's probably right outside the door. And then he isn't. Next year in Jerusalem, right? But this is where he's getting the cornerstone quotation. And in fact, if we look back at King Nebuchadnezzar, what he was doing was just imitating Nimrod. And we read that in the passages about Nimrod and shepherding, if we had done the first session first, that the seven shepherds and the eight princes are going to be able to basically smite the Assyrian. They're going to be able to smite Nimrod. And you're saying, well, Nimrod's long dead. No, he isn't. That same spirit that Nimrod had that said, I can build a tower up to heaven and I can call all the nations in to help me. They say he was the first one who wanted to be a king and worshiped by all. Nebuchadnezzar just tried to do the same thing. In fact, we have pictures where he built ziggurats based on that pattern. The engineering, it had to be built that way, and that's why it mentions the mud bricks, because they didn't have stones for foundation. You had to use mud brick. And it had to be done in just those patterns of a ziggurat for it to bear the weight. So it goes back. Nebuchadnezzar's just trying to imitate and to prevail. And if you've ever talked to people who have been incarcerated, even repeatedly, and you ask them, you know, what went wrong here? They'll say, well, I did this one thing wrong, so if I do it again, I won't do that thing, I'll do this thing, and then I'll get away with it. King Nebuchadnezzar had the same mindset. Well, Nimrod did this, but he did this wrong, so I'll do it this way, and I will prevail. But in all those plans of all the antichrists, all the anti-messiahs through the generations, we have always managed to have at least three Hebrews who said, I won't bow to your idol. I never will, no matter what it costs me. In fact, tradition tells us that Nimrod threw Abraham into a fiery furnace and nothing happened to him. He escaped. So what does King Nebuchadnezzar do to the three Hebrews? Throws them into a fiery furnace. Same thing happens. They're not even singed. But Psalm 118:22 says, the stone, the Evan, which the builders rejected, has become the chief cornerstone. And if we look at the meanings there of corner, there's still a town in Israel today called Rosh Pina, which is the head of the corner. It can also mean a prince of the people. It doesn't have to mean a corner. It can also be like the chief. That's why it says the chief cornerstone. It can be a prince of the people. We still have a stone who is the prince of the people. We still have the one that was rejected by others, but he is our prince. He is going to be that eighth prince that Micah prophesied about that would deliver us from the Assyrian, that will deliver us from Nimrod, that will deliver us from Babylon. So I want to show you something, Peter preaching in context. In Acts 3, and we've read this a lot, but we didn't always catch everything that was happening. And this is, some of the disciples are going up to pray at 3 p.m. in Acts chapter 3, which we know they're going up to pray what is called the Shemone Yisrael, or the Amidah, which is the standing prayer. You would pray it around 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock, we say, is the time, but you can pray it a little bit before, a little bit after. It's called the Mincha prayer, because a mincha gift of grain is what a poor person brings. And they say that, you know, the poorest people of all, they bring the grain. So it's mincha. And what Peter encounters is a truly poor person. As he's going to pray the poor man's prayer, he runs into a man who is sitting there, and he's been there for the past 40 years. He's been lame for 40 years. And the mincha prayer, if you remember, Isaac was how old when he married Rebecca? About 40? Well, he's credited with instituting the mincha prayer. And so he's lying at a beautiful gate to the temple. For him, I'm sure it was a little less than beautiful, because he sits there day after day after day, and he can't walk. He cannot go in and pray the standing prayer because he's lame. And I can't even imagine what it would feel like to sit at the gate to the temple, to be that close. I mean, that close, and you can't get in because you're defective, because you're without hope in this world. You're basically a stranger to what is inside. You're right there. You're that close, but you're on the outside. There's an understanding about the mikveh. And a mikveh is an immersion pool. The rabbis came up with a certain amount of water that had to be inside a mikveh in order to be kosher. In order to qualify where you could actually get up under there and get the proper immersion. And it's based on this Song of Songs, chapter 1, verse 3. It says, he will purify me. He will attach me to himself. And so that attachment, if we read back earlier to the earlier verse where it says, he will attach me to himself, it has to do with the kiss. He will kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. That's what I say, if you figure out what a kiss is in Song of Songs, it's not that racy anymore. But it can even mean like to arm someone, like an archer. It has all these meanings. But one of those meanings is to attach and to purify. And it says if this mikveh is insufficient, if there's not enough water in this mikveh, but this mikveh next to it has the proper amount of water, then you can attach the two. And you can create the 40 seah of water by joining one to the other. In other words, you can pipe it in. Now, for those of you who can visualize Hebrew letters, how many of you know what a mem looks like? Okay, how about a mem sofit? Right? There's a little bit of difference in the two. The mem sofit, which is a final mem, it only occurs when it comes at the end of a Hebrew word. It's completely sealed up. There's no openings in it. It just looks like what it is. It's a pool. Pretty much a circle of water. In fact, it's a sealed garden. The Garden of Eden is a sealed garden. It's sealed away from us right now. Since sin entered into the world, the garden raised up a little bit, and now we have to have our eyes lifted or open to be able to see into that realm. But it's referred to as a sealed garden. Yeshua described it on the last great day of Sukkot. He said, "He who is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. For as it is said, out of his belly will flow rivers of living water." And this he spoke of the Holy Spirit. The first place you read of these rivers of living water is in Genesis chapter 2 in the Garden of Eden, that describes the rivers of Eden as going in concentric circles around the tree of life. So Yeshua is saying, "I came from the sealed garden." Why would that be of interest to people? Well, if we are the mem, if we're just the average, everyday mem of Mayim, then it means we've got a little spout at the top of our pool, and then we've got a little opening down there at the bottom of our pool. The opening is said to be for repentance, but what's the spout for? Remember what the rabbis say. If this one is deficient, if there's not enough living water in this pool, then you can attach, which is where may he kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. It says the water from this mikveh can be piped, can flow into this mikveh, and now this one will come to the 40 seah. It will be completely pure, completely healed. And if you look at mayim, that spells water, you have both kinds of mems with a yod in between. A yod is a hand. How many times is Messiah referred to as the right hand of the Father? So Yeshua is telling us, where is your healing going to come from? Where is your purification going to come from? If you're deficient, and we are, how do you get filled up with that 40 seah of living water from the garden? He says, come to me. Come to me and drink. May he kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. It means I tap into his mikveh, which is that sealed garden of living water that never runs dry because the water comes from the throne. That water will never stop coming from the throne. That means Yeshua will never be empty. That means we can never be empty if we allow him to pour into us. But that opening there is for repentance. So we've got this lame man who's been lame for 40 years. He's deficient. He can't walk into the temple, which is going to be representative of the garden, of being restored back into the garden. That's what the temple services do. They give you all those pictures of what it means to re-enter the garden. And Yeshua says, I am those rivers of Eden. I am the rivers of living water. And Peter knows this. And Peter says, you know what? King Nebuchadnezzar had gold. The Greeks had silver. The Romans had iron. He says, but silver and gold I don't have. But I do have something. I do have the name like purified oil. And there is no other name under heaven by which men can be saved. It is that name like purified oil. He says, I know the mikveh above. I know what you need. You need living water. You don't need the kingdoms of men. You don't need images. You don't need coins, because all those coins do is they show you which king or queen or rulers on the throne at the time. But I want to show you the King of Kings. And so in the name, like purified oil, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, the anointed one, the one with a name like purified oil, who makes the maidens glad, those who have been separated, those who have been kept away, those who had no hope in this world, all that man had a hope of was a coin in the basket up to that time. And Peter says, I have something better than a coin in a basket. I want to connect you into the upper waters. Yeshua can heal you. I can show you what life is going to be like when you enter into the garden. That's all I have. Which one do you want? Do you want a few coins in your basket for the kingdom of this world? See, that's what I mean. If you know the point, you can suffer anything. You can suffer not having a lot of coins in the bank account. If you know that Yeshua has come to bring strength into your feet, it says he went walking, leaping, and praising God. Do you know what's in Psalm 118 that Peter loves to preach from? Go back and see if it doesn't talk about walking, leaping, and praising God. Because his mercy endures forever and ever and ever. His name is the one like purified oil. And so right now we see the kingdoms of men are in a lot of chaos. We see that all around us. Peter came to a point where he wasn't distracted by the chaos. The people who ask Yeshua in the temple, "Are you the Messiah? Tell us plainly." Because what they're asking, "Would you please get rid of Rome for us? Would you get rid of these abominations that are controlling the temple? Who have control of us economically? Who have control of us militarily? Who have control of us politically? We're helpless with these people. Get rid of them. If you're the Messiah, the prophets say you have to get rid of the red one. Edom was the red one. It was thought to be Rome at the time. You may not want to know who they think Edom is today, but nevertheless, Messiah has to get rid of the red one. He says, my sheep know my voice. Where was the voice first heard? They heard the voice of Elohim walking in the cool of the evening. That voice. He says, my sheep know my voice. And so if you are a sheep, or if you were a shepherd, or if you were both. Most of us are both, right? If you're a teacher, you're probably a student. If you're a student, you're probably a teacher. If you're a sheep, you're probably a shepherd. If you're a shepherd, you're probably a sheep. Because good sheep make good shepherds. Bad sheep make bad shepherds. Bad students make bad teachers. I'm old enough I can get away with saying that. So, if you hear his voice, he might be calling you to gather with other sheep who also hear the voice. It doesn't mean you're going to hear everything alike. But what it does mean that you have a hope of precious value. And you share that hope with other people. And when you find those other people who share that precious hope, you might disagree on some things. But you do agree that you hear the voice walking around the tree of life in the cool of the evening. That's where we're headed. In the next session, we'll get to the third group. I know the judgments in Revelation come in thirds. That, again, is a rabbinic principle, believe it or not, drawn out of this Song of Songs, where he talks about, I'll bring the third part through the fire, but then two-thirds of the earth, we read, is going to be burned up in various ways. We'll look at that prophecy and see how that sets right down into your name is like purified oil, therefore do the maidens love you. Now you know who the maidens are, so now you've got a little decoding device when you're reading the book of Revelation. So we'll stop there. I think we're out of time. That happened to me. I was recording at HRN. You know how you watch the clock and it's counting down, and you know it's about done, and you look up and it said 28 minutes. And I thought, am I in a time warp? I was almost done. And it just instead of stopping, it rolled over. And I thought, 30 more minutes. We don't like it when that happens.
Let's give Hollisa a big hand again. Thank you. She, along with our friend Eddie Chumney, every time I listen to them, you know, through the whole thing, my brain's going, you know, and thank you, Hollisa. And, you know, while she was speaking, a couple things kept going through my head, especially early on in her presentation. And it's something we talk about a lot in Jacob's Tent, and that is we're here to function in your purpose. She put it this way, to do the things that we know we're supposed to do today, but to function in our purpose, which then connects me, connects me back to something I learned from my friend. It's not form that matters most. It's function. Thank you, Brad. Last thing, toward the end, I couldn't help but do this. Give me a C minor chord there, Mr. Bello. We usually do this at Sukkot, but something I learned from you is that Hanukkah is kind of like Sukkot Shani. Hoshavtim mayim besason mimaneha Yeshua. Hoshavtim mayim besason mimaneha Yeshua. Mayim, 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 mayim. Oh, mayim besason. Mayim, 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 mayim. Oh, mayim besason. Hey, 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 hey. Mayim, 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 mayim. Besason, mayim, 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 besason. Ushaptem mayim, besason, mimaneha Yeshua. Ushaptem mayim, besason, mimaneha Yeshua. Mayim, 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 oh mayim, besason. Mayim, 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 oh mayim, besason. Hey, hey, hey. With joy shall you draw from the wells of Yeshua. Amen. Father, we thank you. We're grateful to you, Father, for all your goodness to your people. We thank you, Father, for your servants who you have sent out in this last day to the outcasts and to the exiles to teach us, to point us back to you and to your ways as you prepare to gather your people. So we thank you for Hollisa. We thank you for shepherds like Mark and Tammy. We thank you for all of those, Father, that you have in times past raised up, in this present time are using to call to your people. As it was said today, your sheep know your voice. And so we hear your voice and the voices of those that you send to share and to teach us. Thank you. We are grateful to you. Amen. Got a couple of quick announcements before you dismiss, if you don't mind, please. First of all, once again, if you prior to the meeting, if you purchased, a Shabbat meal ticket and you have not already picked this up, we need you to go out here to the information booth and get your meal ticket. This is for lunch tomorrow after the Shabbat service. So if you purchase those, make certain that you get your meal tickets for tomorrow. You're going to need that, because my understanding is if you don't get it today, you might be out of luck. So this is the last opportunity to get your ticket. All right? And if you did not purchase one of those meal tickets, we have not prepared lunch for you. Dance practice for worship tonight is going to be in the smaller sanctuary over here at 6 o'clock, and that's with Carmen Dahl. And then lastly, we need everyone to, when you leave here just now, as we dismiss, we need you to take your stuff and leave immediately, because what's going to happen, remember this morning I said we're not going to have the river dance, we're going to have the quiver dance. Well, the quiver needs to get in here, and they're going to practice a little bit before this evening's service. So we're going to dismiss. We're going to come back at, 7:30. 7:30 is when we're going to come back. The doors will be open at 6:30-ish, somewhere in there, okay? But our service will start at 7:30, so we'll see you later. Be